High in the Himalayas, cradled by the clouds, lies the country of Tibet. To many it was known as the roof of the world, to the Tibetans simply as Pir, or the land of snows. Tibet is located in the heart of Central Asia. China and India are its neighbors. Before the Chinese invasion, Tibet prevailed as a great nation. It was an independent country for over 2,000 years, with a rich culture and a population of about 6 million people. In 1939, at the age of 4, Lhamo Thundup, a farmer's son from Taktser in Amdo, was recognized as the incarnation of the God King. He was escorted to Lhasa and enthroned as the 14th Dalai Lama, the spiritual and temporal ruler of Tibet. Tibet's spiritual heritage is amongst the richest in the world. Buddhism is the main religion. Only 40 years ago, there were thousands of monasteries all over the country. The monasteries of Sera, Drepung and Ganden were known as the big three monasteries in Lhasa. They were said to house between them some 20,000 monks. The monasteries were not only the main centers of learning, but also charitable institutions and cultural treasure houses. The Tibetans are hardworking, cheerful, and friendly. Religion has always been the heart and life of the people, as over the centuries, it had embedded strong roots to become a part of their daily lives. It is clear that in 1959, China's so-called peaceful liberation of Tibet was actually a case of unprovoked aggression. The Tibetans made a valiant but vain attempt to defend their country and their independence. The Chinese forces were quick and brutal in subduing the people, and Tibet was forced to become a part of communist China. Meanwhile, the Dalai Lama with his family, escorted by Kampa resistance fighters, quietly slipped out of Lhasa. They covered about 300 miles across some of the world's most treacherous mountain territory, over rivers and through valleys and snow-covered passes, to seek refuge in India.
The issue of Tibet is not an issue that concerns the Tibetan people alone. It is an international issue.
The Dalai Lama was followed into exile by about 1 million Tibetans. They reached the Indian border, sick, hungry, and exhausted, with little or no remaining possessions.
I know for my parents it was really hard, sort of being completely uprooted and having to sort of try and start their lives all over again.
In exile, Tibetans developed close communities which helped to keep alive their rich cultural heritage.
So ever since I was a little girl, I've always had this really sad feeling at the back of my mind. It's always been there, this sense of a great loss, a sense of sort of having been cheated of something, having something been taken away.
The Dalai Lama now lives in exile in Dharamsala, a small town in northern India. However, in their homeland, back in Tibet, the Tibetan people were subjected to a systematic program of genocide engineered by the Chinese. My name is Tenzing Norbu. I came from Tibet in 1984. I am from Lhasa. In 1959, I was 5 years old. Until the age of 16, I grew up like all other Tibetan children in Lhasa. At that time, for children to go to school was very difficult. There were hardly any schools, and even for families to afford to send their children to school was impossible. At that time, in the whole of Tibet, 90% of the children were not going to school. The children were spending their time searching for firewood in the mountains, as it was very scarce. The families were very poor. I used to go and search for firewood and come back home very late. At times we were successful, and often we were not able to find firewood. Most of us were surviving on food that was actually meant for the pigs. Sometimes we were forced to work. Most of the children were 10, 11, and 12 year olds. We had to work as hard as the adults.
Chinese come to Tibet as a liberator. In fact, the liberator brought more suffering than the benefit.
Over 6,000 monasteries were destroyed beyond recognition. Today they stand in ruins. The people were forbidden all forms of religious practices and social customs. It was a period of great difficulty and suffering in Tibet. It is not possible for me to express in words the amount of suffering we went through. When I was 16 years of age, in 1970, I was put into prison. The prison was in Sangye, and here they had small cells. And I was put into one of these cells. I remained here for 3 years. It was only during the time of interrogation that I saw other people. Otherwise, most of the 3 years, I was alone in my cell. Food wasn't a problem, but every day I would wonder what would happen to me. When would I be sentenced to death? My mother was also put into prison for 10 years. The reason why I was put into prison was not because I had committed a crime, but because of the fact that I was recognized as a Lama. And Tibetan people continued to respect me. My mother was put into the labor prison in Trapchi. I did not know anything about politics as I was illiterate. Since there was nothing for me to confess, I was locked up in one cell for 2 weeks with my hands and feet chained together. For 8 months after that, I was kept with my feet chained. During that period, I was neither allowed to take a bath nor change my clothes. Religious statues were smashed, artworks that have been preserved for centuries defaced, Buddhist scriptures and texts burnt, and religious objects used to surface the roads. Many of the remaining statues were either melted down or sold in foreign antique markets. At that time, there were more prisons than schools in Tibet. More prisoners than students. Majority of the prisoners, except for a few hardcore Chinese criminals, the rest were Tibetans. At that time, most of the children did not have fathers, as either they were in prison or had already been killed by the Chinese. When China is claiming Tibet to be a part of China, why have they treated the Tibetans so badly? Why destroy our culture? It is ample proof to show that it is a case of oppression. The natural resources were exploited with total indifference to environmental consequences.
Oh, deforestation is already having a negative effect on the environment of neighboring countries, as we see with the toll that floods and similar disasters have taken, for instance, in Bangladesh.
In using Tibet as a nuclear waste dump, the Chinese are endangering all of Asia.
Came to know of Switzerland striking some kind of a similar deal like West Germany with China. The essence of this deal was that Switzerland would buy uranium from China on the condition that China takes back the waste resulting from that quantity of uranium. We appealed to Swiss members of parliament and went to witness the debate. And it was true. The government was trying to push this deal, which, as we saw it, was one with double interest for both parties concerned. Switzerland would get uranium at a cheaper price and would not have to face the problem of disposing the nuclear waste. China had a double interest in earning much needed foreign exchange by selling uranium, of which they're mining a lot in Tibet.
Tibet now!
With the dumping of nuclear waste, imagine the contamination impact on Asia, on the world, by careless dumping of the nuclear waste, radiation. Now, Tibet is surrounded by the two most populous nations in the world. And having the main river source in Tibet and contaminated water coming into these two areas, imagine the human destruction. It's incredible.
The communist government has resettled 7.5 million Chinese in Tibet.
One of the crucial, one of the serious matter is the population transfer, Chinese population transfer into Tibet. And that's really a serious matter. So if present situation remains another 10, 15 years, then Tibetan will be insignificant in their own land.
In recent years, the United Nations has passed three resolutions condemning the Chinese occupation and calling for the implementation of Tibet's right to self-determination.
The United Nations has adopted three separate resolutions against the human rights violations being practiced by China in Tibet. Since the United Nations has implemented the resolutions adopted by United Nations in freeing Kuwait, then the United Nations must also exercise the same obligation to bring influence, economic sanctions or whatever it is, on the People's Republic of China. Because if you have two different standards to measure the same situation, then you don't have a principle. And the United Nations, if they don't do this, then the United Nations is a hypocritical institution that is only there to serve the wishes of one or two countries.
The Dalai Lama was awarded the Nobel Peace Prize in 1989 in recognition of his non-violent struggle for Tibet's independence. January 1991 saw the US launch Operation Desert Storm, which was successful in liberating Kuwait from Saddam Hussein.
In the Gulf case, it's a clear indication and signal that the United States people and the government will not tolerate the type of a totalitarian expansionism that is taking place around the world. And if it is wrong for the Kuwait, the Iraqis to rule over or to control, take control over Kuwait, then it is absolutely clear that China's control over Tibet is an unacceptable situation.
It was billed as the biggest ticker tape parade in history, and it was a feast of sight and sound and a spectacular tribute to the men and women who served this nation in the Persian Gulf War. Perhaps before the parade you heard the numbers. Believe them. 200 miles of ticker tape, 10,000 pounds of confetti pouring down, thousands of balloons floating from some 30 financial district skyscrapers, the cheering nonstop. 24,000 in that line of march from all 50 states and 17 nations that supported the fight to liberate Kuwait from Saddam Hussein.
For generations, America has led the struggle to preserve and extend the blessings of liberty. And today, in a rapidly changing world, American leadership is indispensable. Americans know that leadership brings burdens and sacrifices. But we also know why the hopes of humanity turn to us. We are Americans. We have a unique responsibility to do the hard work of freedom.
Before meeting with President Bush in the spring of 91, the Dalai Lama branded US policy unequal and unfair for supporting some nations such as Kuwait's claim to freedom and self-determination while virtually ignoring the plight of Tibet. The Dalai Lama was warmly received by members of Congress in the Capitol Rotunda. He insisted that if the world truly hoped to see a reduction of tyranny in China, it must not appease China's leaders. Offering of most favored nation status to China shows approval of Beijing's brutal policies in China and in Tibet. Policies like the use of forced labor and child labor to make the goods exported by the hardline Communist Party forces.
You do not reform a world by ignoring it.
Mr. Bush told Yale's graduates that he will again seek to renew unconditionally most favored nation trading privileges for Beijing. These extend China the lowest possible tariffs for its exports to the U.S. Congressional opponents had argued that China's continuing human rights abuses since the brutal crackdown against the students on Tiananmen Square 2 years ago should not go rewarded.
The president's policy with respect to China is without any moral or logical basis.
In spite of the strong disapproval by members of Congress, President Bush again has been successful in renewing most favored nation status to China, thereby going against the principles of the Constitution.
You here enjoy freedom fully. And many people, you see, consider America as a champion of liberty and freedom. But I think American, as an American people, I think it is very, very essential, you see, to keep these principles.
In places like Eastern Europe, South Africa and Kuwait, events have transformed the political reality and given meaning and renewed life to the words freedom and human dignity. But Tibet today continues to suffer harsh oppression. The unending cycle of imprisonment, torture and executions continue unabated. The Tibetans dream of a free Tibet and strive to make this dream a reality. This dream can come true if we free Tibet now.
Oh.